at the cross. The Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away. My night was turned to day.
Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
And all the people of God said, amen, yeah, baby, praise the Lord, etc., etc.
Yes.
Good amen. Morning to you, and we hope that you have received a bulletin. There is much information there. We won't take time to read it to you. That's why we provide bulletins, so that you can look it over and make note of what dates are appropriate for you. There is one announcement that I would like to add to the list. Next Sunday is a fifth Sunday month of October. Four times a year, there are five Sundays in a month. And we have begun since August to have on the fifth Sunday a fifth Sunday worship celebration.
Amen.
And so next week, we will have a fifth Sunday worship celebration. We say, well, what does that include? It includes celebrating and praising the Lord around the theme that we've had as we've been looking at the Romans passages, which is God's amazing grace. And what we'll be doing, we'll be singing more music than typically we sing, built around the theme of God's amazing grace and how He likes to be involved in our messes. His amazing grace. Amen. So there'll be much music, more music than normal. Rather than my preaching from one passage, I will lead us in reading several passages of Scripture together. In fact, the Scriptures are going to focus on the great covenants of God, four of them in the Scriptures, with the last one being the new covenant. And we will end with celebrating the reality of the new covenant. And we will also celebrate and commemorate the new covenant by partaking of the Lord's Supper together. And so it's just going to be a little different service. It's going to be a great time of worship, a great time of celebration. And in fact, I think it's a good time to invite some friends and family. I really do. Because it's one of those, it's more loosely organized. And it's just a more freeing kind of service. And to be very honest, when we talk about God's amazing grace, I also believe that when we observe the Lord's Supper, it's a tremendous opportunity.
Absolutely.
To tell people, yes, about the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. And they're not only invited to participate in the Lord's Supper, but before that, they're going to be invited to receive Jesus Christ. Amen. Into their lives. So that's next Sunday, and we hope that on the fifth Sundays now of each, when we have a five Sunday month, that you will be aware of it. Well, one more time. We're coming from Romans, and as we look together again at Romans chapter 8 today, I would like to use as the call to worship the words that are found in Romans 5:20 in the Message. Sin did not and does not have a chance in competition with the aggressive forgiveness we call grace.
Amen.
When it's sin versus grace, grace wins hands down. I'm reminded of the popular song by Matthew West,
yes,
that says, grace wins every time.
Yes.
And we're going to celebrate that together. Father, thank you for this amazing grace that we can experience. And our prayer is that as we celebrate and commemorate what you have done and what you are doing, and today what you will do, may our hearts be strangely warmed, and may a fresh movement of your Spirit sweep across our hearts,
yes,
so that our lives will reflect your amazing grace.
Yeah.
So now, Lord, as we sing music that points to your amazing grace, may you do your work.
Yeah.
In Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
And amen.
You know, I was reading in Romans, different translations of 5, 6, and 8. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to read a little bit of 7. So I popped that thing open, read a little bit of that, and I thought, I don't have a clue what he's talking about. And I mean, I'm here to tell you, I thought, I don't understand what he is even talking about. And then, you know, my little simple mind said, this is what I know. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
Right, right.
And that's good enough with me.
Yeah, that's it.
So I'm just saying there's a reason we skipped 7. Because I tried to read that thing and you told me not to. But I did. But I'm thinking, I don't know what he's talking about. But I do know this. Jesus loves me, this I know.
Amen.
For the Bible tells me so. And I'm thinking, that's really all I need to know. And that's where I need to build my foundation. So we're going to sing Love Lifted Me, because that's what I know. And you might want to stand up when you sing this. And I want to hear the even me's, guys, okay? All right, here we go.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me.
Oh,
chorus. Instead of saying, it is, I want you to say, I have. Okay? I have joy unspeakable and full of glory, okay? I have joy. We gotta have the joy. I don't know if you've looked around at society, but there's not a whole lot of joy going on there on those faces. I realize you can't see this much, but there's not a lot of joy under there. So we gotta have it. And we gotta start spreading the seeds, okay? Let's do verse 3 and 4. I have found that hope so bright and clear. The realm of grace. Oh, the Savior's presence is so near.
As you take a seat, I'd invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Romans chapter 8 again. We would like to read verses 18. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I know some of us here have lost their children, and my mom has lost some of hers, and she's still alive, and it has to be the hardest thing, but I thought that was really inspiring. We have to love the Lord more than our own children, our spouses, and I just want to say today that I love the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
And he has been so good to Keith and I, and praise him. I have a job I start on Tuesday.
Oh, praise him.
And I'm just so blessed.
Amen.
And I couldn't sit down.
You're fine. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that joy that's unspeakable.
Yeah. Praise God.
And we are grateful to Brian. He's never sat at the drums before, he told us. And when he went over there, Holly fainted. She said, "You've released an animal." But
so. And we're good with that.
So she fits right in, right?
If we see me,
that's right.
Not a drummer.
Yeah, but you. Thank you so much. Yeah, you. Thank you so much for your willingness to help. And today we're going to bring it close to our actual looking at Romans 5, 6, 7, which we did refer to last week, and chapter 8. But if you would, follow along as I read verses 18 and down through verse number 30. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us.
Amen.
For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of all of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently.
Right.
In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who've been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those He destined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. And those He justified, He also glorified. Please notice that last verse, which is going to be the icing on the cake of what we have been studying. Notice God's perfect plan. He has predestined every single one of us to be all that He wants us to be. He has called every single one of us to experience what He has to do in our lives. And you know what? He also justifies us. And because we are justified, and because we are the people of God, and because we are becoming His people, being transformed, we've got a great promise. We will experience what it is to be glorified. May God's richest blessings be upon His word.
Amen.
We're going to sing "At the Cross, Love Ran Red" again this week. And last week we had reintroduced that to you. It had been a long time since we had done that. And so I'm hoping that you'll be able to feel a little more comfortable with it and really listen to the words as you sing. Shame are powerless.
want to pray together. And as we continue in this attitude of worship, I'd like for us to sing this next song. It's a very simple song, but it just summarizes what we are experiencing as we think of God's amazing grace. It's "I Sing Out a Love Song." In moments like these, I sing out a love song.
Amen.
A love song to Jesus.
Amen.
And I love the chorus. It simply says, "I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord." So let's prepare to open up our hearts in prayer by singing a love song to Jesus.
In moments like these, I sing.
Our eyes seem to follow our hands.
Singing out.
Busy world, in a hectic world, in a crazy world. Sometimes it's challenging to allow your spirit to bear witness with our spirits, to just have you quiet our hearts and remind us of your amazing grace. And Lord, today you've not only through reading of scripture and singing the songs of the church, but you've enabled us to reflect. And now today, at this moment right now, we just pause to say, we love you. We're humbled by the amazing grace that you have poured into our lives. We are reminded of what Paul said in Romans as we introduced this passage of scripture a few weeks ago, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And Lord, we just pause to say thank you and to say we love you. We confess to you that there are times when that love tends to wane. We are found in our humanity that the bombardment of life tends to want to drown out the hope and the joy of the Lord. But Lord, we're so thankful that we can come to a gathering like this, and we can look at each other in the eyes, and we can listen to each other sing, some pretty beautifully, others of us not quite so beautifully. But Lord, what's so beautiful is the fact that we have a oneness and unity of heart. Our focus for life is the same. Our focus is that in all things, God is working to accomplish His purposes. And Lord, our prayer is today that we would just be reminded of that as we bask in the glory of your presence. We do take time to pray for those two columns of names that are on our back of our bulletins. And Lord, we have brought these before you for some for weeks and some for even months. And we just want to say that we love you. And we're deeply humbled by the fact that you have not given up on any person who's listed on this paper.
Thank you.
And our prayer is that as we think of these, as we maybe look at one or two of them, not only now, but in the days ahead. May they find that your grace is sufficient. And may they hear you singing over them. And may they hear that you are singing a love song over them.
Yes.
And Lord, I pray that as they hear you singing your love song over them, that they would experience the grace and the courage, and they would have the faith to sing out a love song to you also. Again, Lord, thank you for the simplicity of worship. Thank you for the deep teachings of the church. But also, as Ruth said, thank you for reminding us of the simple truth that Jesus loves us, and the Bible does tell us exactly that. And so as we end our time of worship together here, and as we enter into the time of studying the Word, as we close our time of prayer, we just sing through it one more time. In a moment like this, we just want to sing out a love song to Jesus. Let's sing it through one more time, could we?
In moments like these, I lift up my heart. I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands to the Lord.
And this is what we say to him.
Singing I love you,
experiencing his amazing love, expressing that love to him. The appropriate way to end the time of prayer is amen,
amen.
And amen. Have you noticed how many of us go to extraordinary lengths to avoid discovering or learning the endings of films we haven't watched or books we haven't read? The fact is, if one of our friends slips up and spills the surprise ending, we get rather irritated and upset. The movie reviewer Roger Ebert once warned his fellow critics that they never have a right to play the spoiler. Now, my wife is a big Ohio State Buckeye fan. I like the Buckeyes. She loves them. In fact, one time when I was traveling, I was leaving town about 12 noon to drive to Indiana for start a revival, and she had the option of having lunch with me before I left town, or going with our daughter-in-law and son to a sports bar and watch the game. Guess what she chose? Now, sometimes schedules are such that we have to DVR the games and you watch them later. And I've learned that even though through my phone I get updates on the score, that I dare not tell her that I know what the score is. She always wants to be aware of a spoiler alert. I function with spoiler alerts. Spoiler alerts. Don't let the end of the story, don't let it be known. It's interesting that some researchers at the University of California, San Diego, suggest that spoilers don't spoil stories. Instead, contrary to popular wisdom, they might even enhance our enjoyment of a story. The study ran three experiments based on 12 short stories. Each version of the story was read by at least 30 people, and surprisingly, the researchers found that the study participants preferred the spoiled versions of suspenseful stories. In one case, participants were told before the reading of the story that a condemned man's daring escape is all just a fantasy. We're told before reading the story that the condemned man's daring escape was all fantasy before the noose snaps around his neck. The spoiler alert helped them enjoy the story even more. Now, one of the researchers had an interesting theory why people like getting a spoiler alert, and I quote, "It could be that once you know how the story turns out, you are more comfortable processing the information and you can focus on a deeper understanding of the story." Notice, it could be that once we know how the story turns out, we are more comfortable processing the information and we can focus on the deeper meaning of the story. The Apostle Paul didn't have the University of California at San Diego do research for him, but he fully understood, I believe, because of his walk with God through the presence of the Holy Spirit, he understood that we, as followers of Jesus Christ, if we are going to be comfortable in processing what God is doing in our lives day by day and with each passing moment, we have to know how the story ends. How the story ends enables us to process the daily life of faith. Now, what Paul has been doing, he's been telling us God's amazing story of grace. And just for a quick review, we remind ourselves that in chapter 3, verse 10, he tells us, "There is no one who is righteous, not even one." And he looks at the Jewish people, and he says, "Hey, I know that you have the promises of God, and I know that you are God's chosen people." But he says, "What I want you to understand, my fellow Jews, is this. It's God's amazing grace. And outside of him, there is no one righteous, not even one of us." In fact, in Romans 3, chapter 20, or verse 22 and 23, he says, "There's no difference. All." I looked at the word "all" and your picture and my picture is there. "All have sinned and come short and fall short of the glory of God." We miss the target. But the good news is, chapter 3 of Romans, verse 24, all are justified freely. Even though we all have missed the mark, God has made provision for us. And through faith in Jesus Christ, we can be justified. We can have experienced redemption through the fact of Jesus Christ. And we get to Romans chapter 5. He says, "We have been justified through faith. We have peace with God." Amen. That's God's amazing story. Yeah. And we are justified. We have a clean slate. We have peace with God. And so Paul wants us to understand that we are experiencing a freedom. It is a freedom from the penalty of sin. We don't have to keep looking back, wondering if our past is going to get us. Because it is under the blood, we are freed from the penalty of sin. Then we moved into Romans chapter 6, and we discover by looking at chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, and looking at chapter 6, verses 11 through 14, that God not only wants to justify us, he also wants to sanctify us. He wants to set us free, not only from the penalty of sin, but he also wants to set us free from the power of sin. Right. And we have been initially sanctified. We are born again. And the truth is, because of the fullness of the Spirit, we can be entirely sanctified, and we are set free from the power of sin. I don't have to fall to the same temptations week after week, month after month, year after year. We are freed from the power of sin. And then last week, we began to look at chapter 8, and we noticed that 21 times Paul refers to the Spirit. He wants us to understand that we can be transformed. It's one thing to theologically say that we are freed from the power of sin, but practically, I just don't see it happening. And Paul says, hey, we don't have an excuse, because the truth is we have the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. We are sourced, we are strengthened, we are empowered, not in our own strength, not our own humanity and ability to pull up the bootstraps and make it. No! You can't discipline yourself into transformation. You have to have someone working deep within you, and that person is the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yeah.
So we have justification, a clean slate. We have sanctification, power from the freedom from the power of sin. I can say no to sin. And we also have the reality of transformation. Now, last week, when we got to the end of our passage, we read verse 17, and he introduces a word there that we struggle with. It's a word that humanity has struggled with for all times. Some believe, I behold, that the earliest writing that we have in our scriptures is the book of Job, because it deals with the universal problem. The universal problem is, why do we suffer? And in verse 17, Paul brings up this idea, this subject of suffering. He says, if we are children of God, and we are heirs, heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings. There it is. There is that word. You know, why do I suffer? Why does not life go as I hoped it would go? If God really loved me, he would not allow me to go through this. He has the power. If he's really all sufficient, if he's really all powerful, why does he? And Paul says, I want you to understand something. I want you to understand that we share in the sufferings. Christ himself suffered, and we share in his sufferings. Why? In order that we may also share in Christ's glory.
Amen.
In verses 18 through 30, Paul provides the followers of Jesus, those people in whom God is fulfilling his plan and his purpose, he gives them a spoiler alert. God lovingly informs us of how the story is going to turn out. He deeply desires that we process what is happening in our daily lives so that we have a deeper understanding of his story. And once we have a deeper understanding of his story, I would like to propose to you, based on what we're going to find at the end of this section, we have a deeper life-transforming faith. Notice I did not say a situation-transforming faith. but a life-transforming faith. You see, what we need to understand is that God is doing His amazing purposes and fulfilling His amazing plan in our lives. And what we need to understand is that there is a connection between suffering and glory. And what He's going to do in these next 13 verses, He's going to give us some principles that help us connect suffering with glory. And what we need to understand, my friends, here's the title. It's the reality of glorification. And what God is doing, what His plan for us is, that we not only be free from the penalty of sin, we're not only be freed from the power of sin, that we not only be transformed because the Spirit is working within us, but you know what? There's coming a day when we will actually be freed from the presence of sin. And it's not today. That's where we fail to carry through with the thinking. Please notice the development. You said you've said it 7 times a day and 27 times in a month. I want us to really grasp this. Because in times of difficulty, in times of separation, in times of isolation, when the going gets tough, it's easy to forget the truths of God's Word. And we begin to put our concepts and read them into the Bible instead of allowing the Scriptures to teach us and remind us. And so here's the good news. We are justified. We can be freed from the penalty of sin. And all the people of God said, yes! And we can be freed from the power of sin. The Holy Spirit can work in our life. And we don't have to say yes to the things we've always said yes to. We don't have to be in the same habits. Our lives can be different. What I was 5 weeks ago, I'm not anymore. What I was 5 years ago, I'm not like that anymore. What I was 5 decades ago, I'm not like that anymore. I may have been born that way, but I've been born again. And I have the Spirit who lives within me, and so I'm different. And here's the good news. In the future, at glorification, we're going to experience freedom from the very presence of sin. Let's look at the principles. First of all, verse 18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. He introduced us the subject of suffering, and He also introduces to us the subject of glory. And to show how He wants us to carry this all the way through, come down and look at verse 30. In other words, the parameters, the beginning and ending of this passage of Scripture talks about glorification. He predestined, He calls, He justifies, and those He justified, He also glorifies. Glory. And He wants us to understand this principle. Our glory will outweigh our sufferings. Our glory will outweigh our sufferings. Glory is the central theme of this section of Scripture. Well, what does the dictionary say glory is? Well, the dictionary says that glory means great honor, praise, distinction accorded by human consent. Glory involves doing or being something great and having other people recognize and applaud that greatness. A baseball team comes from 3 games behind to win the World Series. And all the people of Boston said, yay! Several years ago. You know, the curse was broken. The blaze of autumn foliage on an October morning. Glorious. A child's artwork hung on the refrigerator for all to see. Glorious. A student walks across the platform to receive the diploma. Glorious. A man and a woman declare love for one another on their wedding day. That's glorious. But you know what's even more glorious? Is 50 years later, that same man and woman are toasted because they've shared life together
for 50 years. Glorious. Glory is something or someone at its best. And it's seen and it's celebrated by others. And what we need to understand is that glory is what God promises to those who turn to Him in faith. Amen. Glory is the end game of God's eternal purposes. And I choose my words very carefully. Glory is the end game, notice end game, not the game, but the end game of God's, not temporal, eternal purposes. And in verse 17, Paul prepares us for this discussion that he has. He not only wants us to understand and realize that our glory will outweigh our suffering, but if you look back at verse 17, the last verse we looked at last week, he says that glory is found through suffering, and that there's no glory without struggle. Huh? That's not what I want to learn. That's not what I want to believe. Again, we have to be cautious of misunderstanding the truth. Glory leads through suffering. Now, of course, the question is at this point, well, why do we suffer? Four real quick reasons. First of all, because of our choices. Because we have sinned or we've done something foolish, we bring trouble on ourselves and into our lives. The truth is, we can ruin our health by choices we make. We can sabotage relationships because of choices we make. Why do we suffer? Well, other people can inflict suffering on us. The reality of abuse, neglect, betrayal, abandonment. Another one, we live in a fallen world. My friends, we live in a world where sin abounds. And we need to understand that when humanity falls, when Adam and Eve, representing humanity, fall in the Garden of Eden, all of creation is impacted. And we won't take time to look at it. We don't have the time to look at it, but we read through it. Creation itself is crying out, could we please return to the way God has planned it for us? And so could we be free from the presence of sin? We live in a fallen world. Sin impacted all creation. And because we live in a fallen world, the reality of sin brings disease, accidents, and natural disasters. Then, of course, there's the last one. We have an enemy. Why do we suffer? Satan loves to sow seeds of guilt, despair, anxiety, and fear. We are not free from the presence of sin. Glorification awaits us. And while we are here in this world, because we are in this world and sin is present in this world, we will suffer. We will have difficulties. We will face the realities of life. And what I want for us to understand is that here, as in other scriptures, throughout the Bible, the biblical writers are not concerned with the whys and wherefores of suffering. In our humanity, we have to ask her, why? God never answers that. Job argued with his friends and even argued with God. Why? And God simply said, hey, did you create the oceans? Did you create the universes? See, God doesn't answer why. He simply points out to who. Because the writer Paul is not concerned with the whys and wherefores of suffering. What is he highlighting for us? Why does he talk about it? Well, he wants us to point out the reality that we all suffer. Paul himself suffered. Jesus suffered. The Old Testament saints suffered. New Testament saints are suffering. Persecution by the Roman government. That's probably one of the motivating factors for this writing of this letter. He says we suffer. And so he's not concerned with explaining why and wherefore of suffering. You know what he wants to talk about? He wants to talk about the fact that God's transformation process will be completed. We understand that our glory will outweigh our suffering. Verses 19 through 21, he points out another principle, that we will live in a glorious world. Notice will. Verse 19, creation waits eagerly. Creation was subjected to frustration. Verse 20. Creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into freedom and glory of the children of God. A beautiful and wonderful world. That's what God created. However, because of sin, because it's a fallen world, it does not always work the way it should. Rivers overflow their banks. We live close to the Mississippi. I've read some of the histories. The Mississippi River at times overflows its banks. Homes and fields have been destroyed. Tectonic plates shift beneath the Earth's surface. We hear of earthquakes and tsunamis. Because we live in a beautiful, wonderful world, and because it is a fallen world, germs go wild. COVID! Extreme heat and extreme cold sometimes make it impossible to survive. And what we need to understand is that this created world is not getting more and more hospitable. In fact, the world is becoming less and less conducive to life as we know it. But what Paul wants us to understand is that someday in the future, God who created this world is going to recreate it. Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 5. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. That's the story. That's the glory. That's glorification. As children of God through faith in Jesus Christ, we will live in a new world. And please understand, what Paul wants us to understand is that no amount of suffering, no hardship in this life can compare to the glory of the life that awaits us. We not only see that we will live in a glorious world, but in verses 22 through 23, he reminds us that we will be a glorious people. Verse 22, we know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so them, but we ourselves. We who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. We are children of God. We are sons and daughters of God. And in the future, there's going to be the redemption of our bodies. He's talking about the resurrection. There is a future hope for us. Just as Jesus Christ was resurrected, just as he had a resurrected body, and the disciples could see him. And it was an unusual body. I mean, he could walk through walls and suddenly show up. And it took a special glasses to recognize him. But he is the first fruits. And because he is the first fruits, we are going to be a glorious people.
Oh, no more pain. No more surgeries. My knees won't hurt. See, what he wants us to understand is that we are justified, present tense, freed from the penalty of sin. We are sanctified. We are freed from the power of sin. The Holy Spirit is transforming me inwardly, and the habits and patterns of a sin, self-centered life are changing. But praise be to God, in the future, we're going to be a glorious people, and we will experience freedom from the very presence of sin. Well, so? That's why, yes, great theology! Well, I love Paul. He always has great theology, and he always follows it up with some very practical words. In light of the fact of God's amazing story, past, present, and future, when we understand the story, you know what happens? Verse 26 and 27, our prayer life changes. Look at it. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for. Can I be honest? I've been to very few prayer meetings where that was true. In other words, in the prayer meetings where I've been a part of, we knew what we wanted to pray for. We knew what we wanted to see happen. Again, see, we've missed the dynamic of what he's been saying. See, we focus on the suffering, and we want release from the suffering. But he says, you know, when we understand God's purpose, when we understand God's plan, we begin to have a deeper prayer life, and we don't know what we ought to pray. And so what we experience is the Holy Spirit himself interceding for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. You talk about a deeper level of praying. There it is. I know what you need to do. Do it. No. I've got the eternal perspective. And because I have the eternal perspective, I don't know what you are doing. And so I just let my inner being connect with the Spirit who's living in that inner being. And I can't put into words what I want to see happen and what your plans are. So, Lord, Spirit, just take them and bring them to the very throne room of God. Key there. He doesn't say quit praying. He says it deepens our prayer life. Now, not only that, he pulls it all together in verses 28 and 29. And he points out that when we understand the full story, when we understand God's complete purpose and plan, it deepens our perspective of life. Notice how it reads. We know that in all things, God works. King James Version is unfortunate, has been unfortunately taken in by many of us, which reads, we know that all things work. All things is not the subject of that verb. All things work, count me in. No, we know that in all things, God is working for the good of those who love him, who've been what? Called according to his purpose. There it is. His plan. His agenda. Not my temporal perspective, but his eternal perspective. And because I have that, I realize that God, those who God foreknew, he predestines to be what? To be comfortable while they live on this earth. No. His purpose, again, in context, this verse takes on such a deeper understanding of what God's doing.
His goal, his purpose, is not to make you and me comfortable. He's talking about suffering. He's talking about being the people of God in a world that is anti-God. And he says, I want you to understand that his purpose is not to make you comfortable, but his purpose is to make you Christ-like. And everything that comes into my life, I can even become more Christ-like in my attitude, or I can become more bitter and more self-centered and grouchy. That's a pretty big generalization, but I think it's pretty true. Events and the circumstances of our lives, according to what Paul is teaching, are like paint on a palette. And God is painting a masterpiece through the events and through the circumstances of our lives. Amen. I've asked these questions individually for the past 4 or 5 weeks. I feel it's my divine appointment, after examining the truth of God's word from God's word, that I ask these questions one more time. Have I been freed from the penalty of sin? Or does my past still haunt me? And if your past still binds you, admit it. And when you admit it, you will receive the forgiveness of God through Jesus Christ. Amen. If you accept Christ's death as the payment for your sins, you'll be freed from your past. Amen. Number two, have I been freed from the power of sin? I keep missing the mark. And because of God's amazing grace, he'll keep forgiving me. And Paul says, no, 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 no. It's not cheap grace. It's amazing grace. And we don't have to keep missing the mark. And the question is, have I been freed from the power of sin? Have I set the sails of my life to catch the wind, the movement of the Holy Spirit in my daily life, in my daily activities, in my daily responses? Have my sails, are they set to the wind, the blowing of the Holy Spirit, and so that I don't respond the way I used to? Have I been set free from the power of sin? And then thirdly, do I focus on present sufferings and hardships, or do I focus on the future glory of the good news that God has in store for us? The Sistine Chapel, the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, one of the greatest artistic triumphs in history. From 1508 to 1512, Michelangelo lay on his back and painted the Fall and the Flood. But Michelangelo's magnificent art started to fade almost immediately. Within a century of completing his work, no one remembered what the original frescoes had really looked like. Painter Biagio Biaghetti described it in 1936, and I quote, "We see the colors of the Sistine Chapel as if through smoked glass." In 1981, a scaffold was erected to clean the frescoes that adorned the chapel. With a very special solution, Fabrizio Mancinelli and Gil Nugi Cagliucci gently washed a small corner of the painting. They invited art experts to examine the work. The result was stunning. No one had imagined that beneath the centuries of grime lay vibrant colors. This was not the Michelangelo known by art critics. That artist was the master of form, his paintings resembling sculpture more than painting. This new artist was also a master of color, azure, green, rose, and lavender of an amazing nuance. Their success prompted the complete restoration of the ceiling. On December 31st, 1989, the task was completed. It had taken twice as long to clean the ceiling as the artist had needed to paint it. But the result was breathtaking. For the first time in nearly 500 years, people viewed the masterpiece the way it was intended, in all of its color and all of its beauty. What are we waiting for? Why do we sing about God's amazing grace, but fail to receive it into our daily lives? For the first time in many of our lives, we could begin to see the masterpiece that God has intended for us to be, with all its color and all its beauty. Father, as we've looked together these past few weeks, we've been reminded of how temporal we have become in our Christian walk. And Ruth was right. This isn't easy stuff. This isn't daily devotionals to sip while you're having coffee and hope that Jesus makes it a better day because we read some scriptures. These are words written in a very difficult time. And the people of faith were buying into and allowing the half-truths of a fallen world determine what their faith was and how their faith looked. And so, Lord, we're so thankful that you have graciously reminded us of your plans and your purpose. And Lord, it is my prayer as the pastor of this congregation that whether we've heard all 5 or 6 of these messages or we've only heard 20 minutes of one, that you would take those truths that have been uncovered for us and we would allow the Holy Spirit to apply them in our lives. How the world needs to see the beauty and the color of the true people of God. And Lord, if artists and scientists can apply chemicals that restore the beauty of the Sistine Chapel ceiling, how much more could Creator God restore the beauty and the color and the attractiveness and the sweetness and the humility and the servanthood and the love and the patience and the kindness for which we were created to be? Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Whoever hears these words, Lord, please, please, may they be used of the Holy Spirit to not only speak to their ears, but you would speak to their hearts. And we would choose to no longer focus on present sufferings and hardships, but our focus would be on the God who has a plan and who is working in all things to make us Christ-like. It's in the blessed name of Jesus we pray. And all the people of God said, Amen. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your willingness to listen. It was longer than usual because it's heavier than usual. God bless you as you go.
Weakest moment I see you shaking your head and